have a very long and serious affair with the men. They really love to go on Friday evening, which I call date night. Right away, you're greeted with this immense sense of beauty and care. It's not crowded, and it's not noisy, and there's a kind of ease of people not rushing. There's the buzz of conversation. My grand plan is to sketch one thing from every gallery at the Met. There is the serendipity. So when you walk through a gallery and you come upon this statue or this painting or a vase that you didn't know existed, and your breath is taken away. And the same way with people. Somebody walks by and you faint because they're just so incredible looking. We're in New York. So many people are dressed in such an extraordinary way that even if it's normal, it's fabulous. I've always thought that museums save your life. It's a kind of resurrection. And it sounds grand, but it is grand because you connect to something that inspires you or makes you feel happy to be alive. All you have to do to find your balance in this world is to look. There's humor, and there's madness, and there's beauty, and there's yearning. And when you fall in love with the art and fall in love with the person that you're with on a lovely Friday evening, it keeps you sane for at least a few hours.
I'm a poet, and back in 2012, I started doing this project where I would hand out postcards to strangers. I gave out as many as 2,000 over the course of 4 years with the question, "What do you feel?" I found that museums were especially receptive places. So I was here at the museum, and as I walked out of the main doors and I looked to the right, I wondered what it was about you that, like, I felt like you would understand the kind of project it was. I was like, this is someone who I need to give a postcard to.
2 months later, I decided to write back. I wanted to support another art project, but I also wanted to ask what was the point of this project. Surprisingly, I received a really long typed letter. I felt quite impressed that that person took my question so seriously. So we started writing letters back and forth with each other for a few months. I remember the feeling of that kind of intimacy that you have when you share how you feel.
Some of my early memories are of these spaces and these paintings. So for me, the idea that I would meet my life partner here makes sense. People are willing to slow down. For me, the project was not so much about each response as it was about the interaction.
I think museum might be one of the few places left where you commit to open yourself up to feeling something. I think it brought out a piece of our true self.
My grandmother was a public school art teacher. When I was 9 years old, she said, "We're going to visit the Met." I remember walking up the steps like I was walking into a temple and just sensing what a magical place this was. In the 17 years since I moved to New York City, I could not even begin to count the number of times that I've been to the Met. It was really something that I did by myself, a very solitary activity, a place of refuge and respite from my responsibilities, until I met Josh.
Both my mother and my father were artists in New York, but I didn't spend a lot of time here. I grew up in studios, so I was always around work in various states of completion. The way I relate to art is very experiential. When Jared invited me to the museum, I was really, really touched. That was Jared's way of telling me that he was opening this part of his life up to me. He really challenged me to look at art in a more critical way, putting it in its place in history, and it really changed the way that I walk into a gallery.
One of the challenges when you have a museum that covers thousands of years of history is really it's only in the last few decades that a same-sex couple could be represented together without that being deeply coded and obscured by the artist. So it's always very special to us when we do see something on the walls that speaks to a relationship between two men. April 10th, 2015, I brought Josh to the Met. I told him we had a special event to go to, and I brought him up to the roof, and no one was really there.
As soon as Jared turned to me, things started to go in slow motion for me. You know, he said, I feel like I've been proposing to you in my head for a long time.
Experiencing the Met with him was part of why I knew I wanted to spend the rest of my life with him. The peaceful sensation that previously I was only getting if I was here by myself, I got with Josh. And I got down on one knee, and the rest was history.
I taught art for 42 years, and I loved explaining to my students that no piece of art was ever made to be put in the Met. It was a birthday present, or it was an expression of somebody's inner emotion, but it was never meant to be question 13 on an exam or to be locked up in a showcase. It was part of someone's life. I had sort of given up on possibly meeting anybody, and a former student of mine called me and she said, there's someone that I'd like you to meet. I was frankly afraid because I'd been set up on blind dates so many times. I went down to meet Julie for dinner. She was the person who didn't even know I was looking for. And then 2 months later, I wanted to bring her up to New York to meet my dad. We went into the Met. And I told her that I wanted her to see my favorite room, the American Sculpture Garden. And so we were sitting on this bench, and before I knew it, I just said out loud, I really can't picture my future without you. Would you marry me? And I'm not sure who was more surprised when the question came out, because I hadn't planned it. I didn't have a ring. I wasn't on my knee. I was just speaking sincerely and honestly and spontaneously. So when she said yes, it was a good thing the ceiling was high in that room. We soared. It was incredible. And then when I looked up at the trumpeting angel over the pulpit, it was almost as though she was announcing the whole engagement. Cleopatra wasn't impressed. She didn't change her expression at all. The two natures of men, they didn't stop wrestling, but they were our witnesses. And so every December throughout our marriage, we went back up to celebrate our anniversary, and we would make a point of going to that room. We'd sit on the same bench and renew our vows. It was a reaffirmation. Even though that wasn't where the marriage took place, it was where the commitment took place. It was our room. And we found that same spirit in the room every year. It was 1995. Julie had found a lump on her breast. And I remember sitting in the doctor's office when the doctor said it was a cancer. It literally takes your breath away to be faced with those words. Julie was a real fighter. Over the coming years, it returned 4 times. During those 16 years, we enjoyed life. We continued to come up to the Met on our anniversary every year. Those last 8 months when I had taken off from school were among the most intimate, romantic, reconfirming months of our marriage. We were just so in concert with each other. When she had difficulty walking, and I would put my knees behind her legs and help her walk, it was as though we were doing our own choreography. When Julie passed, going back to New York scared me. But when I did finally go back to the Met, I went right to the American Sculpture Garden and took a deep breath and pulled open the brass doors. And instead of missing her, I felt as though I found her there. I knew nobody could see me except for the sculptures and Julie. And so I sat on the bench, and with my index finger, I just carved, "I do," on the bench, real slowly and quietly, to renew my vow as I always had when I was with her there. And each time that I've gone back to the Met, I still spend time on that bench and write that letter. As time goes by, I always feel as though if you didn't know Julie, you'll never know me. But when I go back to the Met, the sculptures knew her. They've never blinked. They corroborate the whole thing that she was alive and we were in love. They remember us.